इज द स्क्रीन विजिबल टू यू पीपल?
यस
ओके
मैम।
Okay, so the title of the subject is Programming in Java and the subject code is 18653. Yeah. So before I briefly introduce you the syllabus of this subject, I just want you to note down the textbook. The textbook that we are referring for this subject is the Java Complete Reference, this one, Java the Complete Reference by Herbert Schild, the 7th edition. Well, so the many books are available in the library, and I have even the soft copy as well, which I'll upload. Okay, so the Java is going to be the completely object oriented language, in which in the module one we are going to study the overview of the Java, in which we are going to discuss regarding the object oriented programming and a simple program. And then we'll begin with the control statements, blocks of code, lexical issues, like class libraries, data types, variables, arrays, and floating point types, characters, booleans, and literals, variables, type conversions. Right. So basically, the first chapter is related to the introduction to the Java, including the very simple concepts like the data declaration and the data types and very simple program over here. So in the module 2, we are going to deal with the operators like arithmetic operators, bitwise relational operators, logical operators, and selection statements, iterations, that is the loops. I hope you remember the loops that you might have studied in the C, and the jump statements like go to and case statements. Right, so everything is going to be the similar kind what you have studied in the C programming language, but the syntax that you have used with that language is going to be different with this language, whereas the concept or the conceptual meaning behind all these concepts are going to remain same, but the way in which they are used here are different as compared to the C, and why they are different we are going to discuss as we proceed with the syllabus. Okay, so coming to the next module, that is module 3, where we are going to start with the classes, which is the main thing with the Java programming language. Here we are going to start with the classes, constructors. Just a minute. Okay, sorry for the disturbance here. Okay, so in the third module, we are going to study the classes, fundamentals, method constructors, garbage collection, returning to the objects, inheritance, all the theory that we might have discussed earlier in the module one, the same theory we are going to study here with the implementation in the module three here. Okay. So module 4 is regarding the packages and the interfaces, where we are going to study the various built-in packages which will be helping for develop the projects very easily. Okay, so in the last module we are going to study regarding the applets and the string methods and the string comparison, printer writer class, reading and writing the files concept, right? So in the last module, we are going to study regarding the main concepts which might be helpful if you want to develop the any projects using the Java, right? So the first three modules are going to be very basic concepts, where we are going to study with the some syntax and the concepts which are related to the Java. And module 4 and module 5, we are going to study in bit detail regarding the packages and the applets here. Okay. So shall we start with the syllabus now, or else do you have anything to ask regarding this subject? Don't be panic. We are going to discuss everything in detail only. Right. So the one thing I just want to tell you that whenever I'm discussing the any concept, and if you are not comfortable or if you are not understanding anywhere at any some point, you can stop me there itself and you can ask me to repeat. So I'm going to repeat as many times as you want until the concept gets clear to you. Okay. So, but for that, I want you people to interact. I just want you to interact and tell me where I need to stop, where I have to explain, and where you are not getting, or when anywhere if you are getting the confusion. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Because what thing happens here is I usually will be handling for the, this is the first time I am handling for the other branch students. Isn't it? It might be even for you also the first time experience, isn't it? So whenever we will be handling for our branch students, we'll be having a certain mindset that they have already gone through the few programming concepts and they might be having some prior knowledge, so that the things might be little bit easier for them. Okay. So I'm not saying that it is going to be very easy for them and it is going to be difficult for them. For them, it is little bit basic. For them is going to be a little bit easier, and for you also it is going to be easier. The only difference is you might have to put some little extra effort. Even I have to put some little extra effort to make you two more easy. Okay. So one more thing is, as I start with the syllabus, I will try my best to make it more easier for you to, by taking some examples from the YouTube or some animation videos I will be playing, so that you understand it very easily. Okay. So even though if you are not getting, then also you can ask me. I am ready to explain it as many times as you want. Okay. And one more thing is, please keep book and pen along with you, so that whenever I ask you to write something, you should note down it. And in between the concepts, I'll be telling you what kind of questions will be asked on the each concept. Okay. So make a note of it, so that it will be helpful for you to prepare for the examinations as well. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So now let's start with syllabus here. So the module one is regarding the overview of the Java here. The screen is visible for you, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So the first and the foremost thing is, do remember here that the Java is completely object-oriented programming. Now, a question may arise in your mind, what is this object-oriented programming, right? So why it is termed as the object-oriented programming, right? So do you have any idea, or else do you remember that what kind of programming was C, which you have studied in your first year? It was said to be as a procedure-oriented programming. I don't know how many of you remember it. Definitely this term has been told to you during the first module of the C programming itself. I don't know how many of you remember it. The C programming language is said to be as the procedure oriented programming language. Okay. So does any one of you remember what is procedure oriented programming language? Say at least yes or no. If you remember, say yes, or whatever you remember, say yes. If you do not remember, say it as a no. At least I will get to know that how I have to explain you, or from where I have to explain you, right? So, but without your interaction, it is going to be very difficult for me to explain you the things, isn't it? So, do you remember, I'm not asking you the object-oriented programming. I'm just asking you, do you remember what is meant by the procedure-oriented programming?
Mm.
No, you don't remember?
Ma'am, which is a list of instructions, ma'am.
Yeah, list of the instructions. Very good. Any other answers?
Mm. And which follows the some order, ma'am.
Yeah, very good. Which follows the some order. So, others? Whatever comes in your mind, no matter whether it is correct or wrong. So, please do interact. Whatever comes in your mind. Okay. So at least you remember how you used to write the programs in the C, how you used to write, or what is the method that you used to write the program, like where you have to start and where you are going to take the in between statements. Probably you,
yes,
you are, yeah, isn't it? So you used to write from the main function. the execution is always going to begin from the main function, and the flow of the program is always going to be from the main to the all other sub functions, which is from the one to the other serially. Is it so or no? At least you remember this. For example, if you have written a C program to add two numbers, very simple, right? So what are the probable statements that you might take? You might take the declaration of the variables, you might take reading of the variables, then you might take performing the addition on it, and then you might take a statement to display the numbers, display the result. Isn't it? So all are dependent on each other statement or not. Right from declaring the variables up to displaying the result on the screen, all are dependent and which are executed serially one after the other. Isn't it? So even though if you take the any sub functions which you might declare outside the main function, even in that case also the execution is going to happen one after the other serially. So this execution, this way of executing any statements one after the other is said to be as the procedure oriented programming language. Do not get overwhelmed with the deep into the concept. So whatever I tell you, just try to grasp that thing. Okay. So the way in which the program executes is one after the other serially. So that is said to be as the procedure oriented programming language. Am I clear with that? If you get to understand this, then it will be more easy to you to get differentiated with the object oriented programming. Is it so? Yes or no? You at least are you clear with the procedure?
Yes, ma'am.
Someone was telling something. Yes.
We can't hear you properly, ma'am.
Voice is not audible.
There is a lag.
Sorry? There is a?
So much lag in audio, ma'am.
To everyone, it is not clearly audible.
It's audible.
No, ma'am. For us, it is clear only, ma'am.
It's clear.
Can you tell me your name? For so that I can communicate properly, or else unless I have to tell just a boy. See, check out your internet connection. If it was from my side, then it should not be audible to the others as well, isn't it? So if it is disturbing or if it is not clear to you, probably there might be some problem in your internet connection. Yes. Okay. So is everyone clear with what is the procedure oriented programming? With contrast to that, procedure oriented programming is said to be as an object oriented programming. So serially execution is said to be as a procedure. Procedure word itself tells you that there is a certain things which has to follow some procedure or the series of the statements, right? So in contrast to this, which is said to be as the object oriented programming. So can you only tell me what is object-oriented programming with contrast to, you can tell exactly the opposite meaning of the procedure-oriented programming.
Which doesn't follow the order.
Yes, which doesn't follow the order. So there might be haphazardly written codes, there are the set of the classes, there will be set of the objects which can be executed at any time. It's not like that you have to execute in the same order what you have written. So there will be a case that you will be executing it in a disorder depending upon the whichever the service that is required at that point of time in the program. So that is said to be as the object-oriented programming. Okay? Okay. So for okay. For this object-oriented programming, the two main things that are used here are the class and the objects, which you will understand when I start with the actual programming. Okay. So the classes and the objects are going to be the main concept in this object-oriented programming. Okay. So in this slide, I have written a point known as the two paradigms. So the two paradigms are nothing but two paradigms are the comparison with the object-oriented programming and the procedure-oriented programming, which I have just now explained to you. Right. So before we start with the syntax or a simple program, you need to understand the some theoretical concept which are helpful or which are going to make this object oriented programming differentiated from the procedure oriented programming. Okay. So one among that is the abstraction. What is meant by the abstraction? For this, we will watch a small video now, which is a YouTube video. You can also randomly search from the internet, but probably you might be overwhelmed with the so many things that has been given over there. So for which I have searched it, which is going to be very short and which might be very helpful for you, right? So can we just watch that video so that you will get to know more easily, right? So after that, I'll explain it with a theory part.
Before we begin, we have to...
Is the audio and video visible to you? Video with
yes,
audio.
Ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. The question, what is abstraction? Well, the definition of abstraction is the act of removing elements of specificity from a diagram to emphasize commonality. But what does that really mean? Well, it's probably easier to explain with an example. Imagine you have a car. The car has a lot of attributes, such as engine type, the number of miles it's traveled, the age of the car, and even the paint color of the car. Now, let's say you're describing your car to a friend. You wouldn't tell him about the engine type or the number of miles it's traveled, because that wouldn't be helpful to helping him find the car. You'd tell him about the paint color. On the other hand, if you were describing your car to a mechanic, he wouldn't care about the paint color. He'd want to know about the engine type, the number of miles it's traveled, and even the age of the car. So, From this scenario, we can see that in real life, depending on the scenario, we describe the same object in different ways. This is abstraction. In everyday life, we use abstraction. So, what is abstraction? Well, it's the process of describing things using only the important details for the task at hand. In a computer context, this involves only providing attributes and methods to an object that are useful for the task at hand. In the practice questions, you will practice this process yourself. You will have to write attributes and methods to describe real-world objects depending on the task at hand. If you get stuck, have a look at the example answers we've provided in the About section of the course webpage. Don't worry if your answers don't match up exactly with ours. Abstraction and design is a very subjective thing, so everyone's designs are a little bit unique. Finally, we will also be using UML diagrams in our...
Okay, so how many of you understood what is abstraction just by that picture? The same example has been example has been given in your textbook as well. The example what he has explained by taking, the same example has been mentioned in your textbook. What is abstraction? Yes. Does
Not audible, ma'am.
Ma'am, your voice is not audible, ma'am.
So I'm really extremely sorry that I've lost my internet connection. So am I audible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So what I was explaining regarding the abstraction, right? So the same example what has been given in your textbook, the same example has been considered even in that video as well, right? So being a driver of the car, just tell me what knowledge you might be having regarding the car, just as a normal driver or the normal user of a car.
About the engine, speed of the car.
You'll be having knowledge about the engine only being a normal driver of the car?
No, ma'am. About the speed of the car.
Yeah, you will be having, see, with which parts of the car you will be familiar as a driver. You might be familiar with the gears. You might be familiar with the clutch, steering, accelerator, brake, and the steering. Probably with the AC, music player, right? So whatever the things that you use as a normal user, isn't it? So being a driver of the or a normal user, you might not be having the any knowledge regarding the how engine works and what are the parts of the engine and how the inner machine of the car works there, isn't it? So that means you as a user, normal user, there are the two parts or there are the certain parts of the car for which you do not have the access or for which you do not have the any knowledge at all, isn't it? Now, when you get the car to the automobile engineer or else when you get the car to a mechanic, right? So where you want to get repaired something. So at that time, the mechanic will have the very much knowledge regarding the all the inner parts of the car. Isn't it? And probably he might not be interested in the color of the car. He might not be interested in the model of the car which you are having. He most probably interested is only in the engine of a car. Isn't it? So to get repaired it. Isn't it? So the main agenda here is the abstraction is nothing but whenever at a task to any particular user, so whichever parts of the program are accessible or useful to them, only that parts is going to be given access. So others will be kept as a hidden or others will be kept as a private, which is not accessible to that user. So that concept of the object-oriented programming is said to be as the abstraction. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So there are the three object-oriented principles. Encapsulation, inheritance, and the polymorphism, which are going to play a very important role to make it as a object-oriented programming. So first we'll discuss regarding this encapsulation. See, abstraction and encapsulations are going to be related to each other, right? So is this figure visible to you people?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so before I discuss this figure which has been given in your book, I'll give you a very simple example which might be very easy for you people to understand, right? So to your home, there will be the n number of the visitors, right? So my question to you people is very simple, that in your home, you might be having a kitchen, you might be having a bedroom, and you might be having a puja room, and you might be having a sit out and a hall, living room, isn't it? Right. So my question to you people is that are you going to allow all the people who are going to visit your house to your puja room, your bedroom and the kitchen?
No, ma'am.
No,
ma'am.
No, right. So there are some category of people, right? So for people who are extremely stranger to you, you might not even allow them to enter your house, right? So there are some people who are familiar to you. You might be interested to make them sit only in the sit out or the living room. Isn't it? So there might be some people who are more close to you or your relatives for whom you will allow them to enter the kitchen or the bedroom. Isn't it? So
yes,
there
ma'am.
Are just some accessibility which you can put a restriction on the people who is entering to your personal areas. Right. So the same accessibilities even can be given for the programming as well. So the data on which the program is working, the methods on which you are defining. So you can put access to these methods and data to differentiate them for the accessing over there. For that accessing, you say it has a access specifiers given by the Java programming language, which is said to be the public, private, and the restricted. Right. So the public in the sense, the one which is applicable to the everyone, the one which is accessible to the everyone. Right. So for some such variables, you declare them as a public, and for some variables to whom you do not want them to be accessed outside, or else you don't want them to be accessible to the everyone. For them, you declare it as a private variables or the private methods. See, variables, all of you are very well to know what is variables. The data or the data storage in which you want to store the values or which you are operating in the program, right? So the methods are nothing but the operations that you are going to do on the variables, right? So I'm speaking about these variables and the methods which can be made as a public or the private. Correct? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So putting a restriction on the data or the methods to make them accessible to the everyone or only for the few. So that concept is known as an encapsulation. Right now, you just understand only the meaning of these terms. So as and when we start with the programming, you will get to know how does it is going to make difference while implementing a program. Okay, so encapsulation is a method to make the variables or the methods to be accessible to the everyone or only for the certain things. So that is said to be as an encapsulation by defining the with a keyword as a public or the private. Okay, so in this figure you can see here a triangle which is displayed on this circle here. So this is said to be as a public. Why? Because it is accessible to the everyone. You can see here the visibility of these triangles are to the everyone, for which you say it as a public. And the methods or the variables taken here inside, which is covered with this public, you can say them as a private, which is not easily private. Accessible to the everyone. This is said to be as the private methods or the variables. So this entire concept of making public or private to put a restriction on the accessibility of the variables or the methods is said to be as the encapsulation.
Encapsulation.
Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So coming to the next concept, which is very, very easy, that is the inheritance, the word which is very much familiar to everyone. So inheritance is not like that. It is a word introduced in this Java programming language. Inheritance is a word which is used in even in the biological term as well. So the same concept has been used even here in the programming as well. So what is meant by the inheritance? What is meant by the inheritance?
Ancestral characteristics.
Yes, ancestral characters, right? So you are inherited from your parents. You are inherited certain characteristics from your parents, isn't it? It might be in terms of the looks. It might be in terms of the behavior as well, isn't it? So you usually hear the things like you look like your father, you look like your mother, your eyes resembles your mother's, your hands resembles, your walking style resembles your father, isn't it? So what are all these things? These are nothing but inheriting the characteristics from the parent to the child, isn't it? So this yes. concept is said to be as an inheritance, for which they have given an example like the last one, which is written here is a Labrador Golden. These are the category of a dog here. But you can see here it is an animal. Dog is an animal, right? So it comes under the class of a mammal. And it comes under the class of a canine, and it comes under the class of a domesticus, and then retriever. These all are the names of biological terms introduced for a dog here, right? Labrador and then golden, right? So why they have given here is, though you say it is a dog here, so you say that this is, belongs to the animal, and you say that it belongs to the mammal. And you say that it belongs to the canine, same way domesticus retriever. So belongs in the sense it will inherit the characteristics of the animal. Even it will inherit the characteristics of a mammal. It will inherit the characteristics of canine and similarly to the other. And along with that, to differentiate that it is a Labrador, to make it more specific, it also have the certain characters apart from all these characters which are inherited from the ancestral here. Isn't it? So the same way is applicable even to you also. You are also an animal, but within that you are a human, and within a human you are an Indian. You are inherited some characteristics from the your parent, and along with that you also have the certain specific characteristics of your own to identify you as a specific individual, isn't it? So yes. The same he said the, so the same thing is even applicable in the Java programming as well. When you start writing the program, you are going to define a class, and to that class you are going to define the one more subclass as a child class, and to that child class you can also define the one more subclass to say it as a grandchild class. So that means that the subchild class is going to inherit the characteristics of the main class. Here, characteristics in the sense the variables and the methods that are defined in the one class. Suppose if you make the any other class as a child of that main class, that child class can easily inherit the all the variables and the methods defined in its parent class. Along with that, it also can have its own methods and the variables. So this concept has been utilized in the Java programming language, which is known as the inheritance. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So follow to that, you have the one more concept known as the polymorphism here. So the name, you should first know what is meant by the polymorphism as a word, and then you will get to know how it is applicable in the Java programming here. Okay. So poly in the sense?
Many.
Many. Very good. Many. So poly, the meaning of the word poly is many, and morphism is nothing but the same kind. So the many of the same kind methods is said to be as the polymorphism. Right. So before I explain you the figure, what has been given here, I think I have taken this figure wrongly here. This is an example of the inheritance only. Okay. So even though I'll tell you what is polymorphism, right? So one simple example is, suppose if you are writing a program for a cat functionality, right? So the meaning of that is the cat, when it smells, it will, when it smells of a food, it will run towards the food. Okay. So when it will smell towards its owner, coming towards him, it will run towards his owner. When it smells towards the mouse, it will run towards the mouse to catch it, right? So what is common in all these things when writing a program? What all the things is common in this?
Smelling and running.
Smelling and running. Very good. So smelling of a cat is where you are going to program it is a common, and running towards that object is going to be a common. The differentiation is type of a smell and the type of the things where it is running, right? So for that, if you are going to do the same thing in the C programming, you might be writing the three separate programs for the each of these things. Like you are going to write the separately smelling program for the food and running towards it, and separately writing a program for smelling of the owner and running towards it, and separately smelling a mouse and running towards it, right? But when you say it as an object-oriented program, due to the polymorphism characteristics, it will allow you to write the program commonly as a smelling and commonly as a running, which can be utilized for the any number of the objects by passing it with the different smells and the different objects where it has to run. You need not have to write the separately for the each of the task here. Instead, you are going to write it only once, and you can use it separately for the different tasks. That is said to be as the polymorphism. Many of the same kind. You need not have to write it separately every time. Getting an idea what is polymorphism? So in simplicity, you can say it as working or writing a method which is going to work for the different tasks. Right? So same program for the many functions. Got an idea?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I think the rest of the things I'll continue in the next class, where we are going to start with the first program of the Java, right? So for time being, I'll just teach you with the program how to run it with the online platform. And later I'll tell you with the installation as well, how you can install the Java in your system and how you need to start the execution. Okay. So what?
Madam, C++ and Java both are object-oriented. Yeah, what is the difference between Java and C++?
C++ and Java. See, C++ is a combination of both the procedure-oriented as well as the object-oriented programming. It is not explicitly only the object-oriented. It is going to acquire the characteristics of the C as a procedure-oriented as well as the object-oriented. But Java is completely object-oriented programming language. Got an idea?
Which one is more preferable?
See, I got it what you are asking here. See, it's not like that. You cannot judge that which language is more preferable, which one is good, which one is efficient. It's not at all like that. You cannot distinguish and you cannot say that the C is the older language and it is not good programming language and Python is a very earliest language what you are using now and it is more efficient. No. Right. So depending upon the project on which you are developing and depending upon the requirements that you have to meet for that project, at that time you have to decide which programming you have to use, right? So as I told you, since it is a object oriented programming, it has a encapsulation characteristics where it provides the more security of a data if you wish to protect it by using the private access specifier, right? So if the project what you are developing requires the more security the data that you want to provide for the clients, at that time you can go for the Java. Correct. Right. So if you wish that if it is okay and if you want the implementation to be by the very size, and at that time you can go for the C programming language. It's not like that or never you can define that the which programming is going to be the best as compared to the other. Every programming language has its own advantages and the disadvantages, but depending upon on which project you are working and the requirements what it has to meet, at that time you have to select the platform on which you want to develop.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Any other queries? Any other queries? Okay. Shall I wind up the class? The further things I'll discuss in the next class.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.